Greetings, fellow investigators, and welcome to our video podcast, Into the Darkness. Today, we are bringing you the Call of Cthulhu Game Masters Forum, and our topic for today is scenario creation, or how to drive players insane on your own terms. We have three special guests on our show: Mike Mason, co-author of Call of Cthulhu 7th Edition Keeper's Rulebook and line editor of Chaosium, Inc., Oscar Rios, editor and president of Golden Goblin Press, and Matthew Sanderson, who together with his partners runs the Blasphemous Tomes website and the Good Friends of Jackson Elias podcast. In addition, we have the director of Elder Sign Studios, Thomas McKean, and two of our prime members, Jeff Wilkins, who's done an outstanding job scaring the crap out of us, and Mick Swann, who is currently working on a homebrew project. Gentlemen, welcome.
Thank you. Happy to be here.
So, because we had enough interest mostly from our game masters, we wanted to know how the professionals write the different scenarios and come up with their ideas. We were given a list of questions. Maybe each one of you wants to say a little bit more about yourself before we start. Matthew?
Hello, everyone. Matthew Sanderson here. Over about 50 miles north of London in the lovely cold and wind and rain at the moment. I've been writing scenarios now for publication for about 5 years. I've written for numerous games, but the big one for me is the Great Tentacle One himself. I suppose my key thing for scenarios is I always like to have something in there about mythology, history, folklore. That's one of my big things.
There. Cool.
Pass over to whoever's next in the list then.
Mike?
Yeah, hi. Mike Mason. I'm line editor at Chaosium for Call of Cthulhu. I guess I don't know how long I've been writing and editing professionally for some time. I've worked for Black Industries for Dark Heresy, the 40K RPG, and obviously for Chaosium for Call of Cthulhu, and done freelancing in between that. I've written a lot of scenarios and run a lot of games and edited a lot of scenarios that other people have written. I guess I've been doing it for a while.
Wonderful. Oscar?
Hi, I am Oscar Rios. I am the president of Golden Goblin Press. I have been writing scenarios for Call of Cthulhu for about 15 years now. I am the author of the campaigns Ripples from Carcosa, The Legacy of Arius Lurko, and I had the high honor of being invited to write scenarios for the second edition of Horror on the Orient Express. That completely blew my mind. I am a lover of history, and I am one of the odd Cthulhu authors who actually likes humanity. So most of my scenarios start from a human place, from the people, the victims, the corrupted, and I build from there. So I guess I build most of my scenarios upside down to the way other people do it.
Cool.
And I've been accused of writing too many happy endings, which I'm trying to get out of. My players aren't happy with that.
Cool. I guess, let's see. Let's look at some of the questions on our list. Where do you find inspiration for games? How do you come up with the idea of what you're going to write? Just whoever wants to talk.
Inspiration just hits you. It's really hard to say where. It could come from 100 different directions. I could be out at a place having really good sushi, and all of a sudden it just sparks my imagination to start thinking about Japan. And 4 hours later, I've got the germ of an idea about Japan. I could be watching a documentary. I could see a story on the news. Inspiration, it comes. You just need to kind of be open to wherever inspiration is going to hit you, and let your imagination carry the ball when you get it.
Wow.
Yeah, I mean, I would agree. I mean, inspiration comes from everything. You know, it's whether you're watching a film, reading a book, listening to a song. Now, I normally find when I'm driving a car with the least opportune moment to actually capture the idea in some way, so I can remember it. Often when I'm driving is when I think of things. But the one advice I would have is carry a notebook at all times, because ideas crop into your head in the most inopportune times, and then you're in the moment and you forget them, and you're lucky if you remember some of them. So having a notebook and jotting the idea down as you have it is a really good tip.
Yeah.
From me, as I mentioned previously, that I've got quite an interest in mythology and folklore and so on. But I buy lots of collections, as per the reference stuff you'll see behind me. I buy lots of collections of small snippets of tales here and there. And I'll flick through those idly or look on websites where people have put up some 14 events and so on. And if anything, again, just has that, well, that bell moment where something rings and I think that, yeah, there could be a mythos spin on that, or any scenario spin on that, really. Then it will kind of sit there and slowly kind of percolate until finally, pop, there's an idea. And I've got through some of Mike's advice there, got through several notebooks of writing things down. So yeah, notebook very, very much gets a thumbs up from me there.
So once you've got the idea, I'm sorry, go ahead, Jeff.
I was just going to say, at that point, do you pretty much just write down whatever pops in your mind, or do you filter it at that point and say, no, that's not a good idea?
No, I just write it as it, whatever came into my head, I just write it down. Mm-hmm. And then I guess Matt probably said the same thing, is that you then now you've written it down, that's part for me, writing it down helps me to remember it. So then it percolates in my head for some time. And it may not be that I come to write that for a month, a year or more, but I can go back to that notebook and then it'll snap back into the things that I, you know, were thinking about and, you know, I've thought about subsequently, I guess.
I mean, it can also be, you start off very differently, that you'll have, say, that one initial idea, and then that could develop into two or three different scenarios, depending where you think, oh, you could go this way. It'd be really nice if it goes that way as well. So, write down all the options.
Whenever I make notes, what usually happens is I will jot down the entire scenario outline in the notes, but it will all be boxes and lines leading to other boxes with two or three sentences in each box. And it'll end up looking like two pages of just this weird flow chart that no one will ever be able to read but me. but if I had to, I could run the scenario from that. And it just kind of lays out my entire clue thread. Again, I guess it's shorthand for scenario notes. So, but I usually don't make notes. But if I have a really great idea and I'm just totally trapped somewhere that I can't get to a computer or a notebook or anything, I'll just grab a piece of paper and a pen and I'll map out the scenario before I lose it.
So you like using the flowchart sort of method too?
Yeah, everybody's method is going to be their method. No, I know a lot of authors. None of us do anything the same. Everybody writes differently because that's what works for them. So the flowchart works for me. I've never met another author who ever used flowcharts in their notes.
Really?
So it may just be my thing. There may be other authors that flowcharts, that's the way to go, and that's the, you know, that's what's going to pull it all together. But really, it's going to be what works for you.
See, it's funny because I have a tendency when I'm going to run one of your games, I write it all out in a flow chart so that I have it in front of me.
That's probably how most of them start.
It makes it easier to figure out, okay, if they do this, then go there and so forth.
Yeah, I mean, that's I don't always use a flowchart. I do one in my head, One of the facilities I have is I can map things in my head and kind of hold them there. But sometimes if it's a problematic scenario or something like that, then I will chart it out, kind of basically just draw some bubbles and lines on a page. But that's I mainly do that. That's kind of a step down the road for me. It's that becomes what I call the clue trail, because you're mapping the flow of clues and you're mapping it against the flow of the players. You know, you're looking at what is the likely route the players will take and does the clue trail match to that? Does it come to a bottleneck? Does it come to a dead end? And therefore helps me to kind of structure the clue trail effectively on top of the trail the players may make, which may be two different things at the start of this scenario.
Yeah. That's actually leads into another question, which is, how do you make sure that the continuity is correct? I mean, you find this mostly in people who have created an amateur game that the logic of the game actually is completely, it falls apart, you know? I don't know if I explained that correctly or...
it depends on the style of scenario you're running. I mean, if you're writing what effectively is a sandbox where you've got a rough idea of a plot, you've got some characters and you've got some kind of, you know, environment, you know, whether it's a, you know, haunted house or a village or city or whatever it may be. And you've got in your head on a bit of notes, you've got a little bit of notes about each of those things, and you can kind of just go with the flow with the players. So you haven't really got to worry about the, you know, the trail in the fact that you'll kind of make the trail as you go. But for a published scenario, you do have to kind of, yeah, think about how the clues connect up effectively. So that is a kind of a mapping exercise, whether you do it as an actual flow chart or whether you just write it all out and then backtrack and, you know, check it all links up. But you're trying to make it cohesive. So there's no loose ends effectively. As you go through the scenario, you kind of have to kind of pull yourself out of it and then just look at it in terms of the players and not what you would do when you run it, but what the players will do. And is it written down? And I'm talking purely for publication, because obviously when you're running yourself, you're running your homebrew stuff, you know what's going to happen next, because you've either got it written down or you'll make it up. It's fine. Mm-hmm. But when you're trying to convey it to another person who you're not going to speak to, you have to have had it written down. So that's where it becomes, a process to map it all through.
I think that to really learn how to write solid, cohesive scenarios, it's an experience. It's an experience that you need to build up. It's something that will develop over time as you write and run games. I would say the most valuable thing a writer can do is to run their scenarios with people who are more experienced than they are. Find the best players you possibly can, run your stuff and watch how they break it. And if they're the kind of group that they're very friendly with you and they will tease the living hell out of you when they break your scenario or there's a very obvious NPC, that pain and suffering and embarrassment will teach you not to do that anymore, and you will get better. My players used to make nicknames for obvious NPCs, like Stabby McStabberson. Oh, this is Stabby McStabberson. And I'm looking two scenes later, he's going to stab somebody. I'm like, son of a bitch. And like, oh, I wonder if we could see the haunted house. And I'm like, well, you see the house? I'm like, oh, there it is. You know, are there bats and lightning going in the background? Like, just teasing the ever-living crap out of me. And it really, I loved them, but it made me angry. And I really wanted to make it better. Play with good people. Let them break your stuff. Let them show you what's obvious, what's illogical, what, you know, I had people derail a game, you know, because they were going to take out the villain with carbon monoxide. It was brilliant, and it completely destroyed my game, so I had to rewrite that. So, you know, play with good people, let them break it in the playtest before you publish, fix it, and then put it out.
I absolutely echo what Oscar just said, but I would go one step further. It's because one of the things I find for newer writers is they don't always capture on paper what's in their head when they're running the game. And when they run the game, it's a fantastic game, the players have a fantastic time, but when they come to write it, they don't always write all the things that happened in their game on the actual page, because it's almost like, well, that's what I do. So I always recommend give your scenario to somebody else to run and either play in it and just play dumb and play a kind of a silent character, or just watch it, or, you know, get the feedback if you can't be there, because that other person running it is only going to be able to run it from what you've written down.
Exactly.
So, you know, so if it's not written down, they will come back to you and say, yeah, I understand this, Matt, but when we got to this point, I didn't really know what to do, because it doesn't really say anything. And so you suddenly know, oh, yeah, I've got to fill that in. I've got to put some more detail in, or whatever it may be. So I do recommend getting somebody else to run it and giving you some, you know, critical feedback, which will really help you to kind of, grow your experience.
Definitely. You always need a second set of eyes. You always need somebody to read it cold who doesn't know the narrative, as if they're going to run it. Because they, you know, you'll fill in the gaps in your head and not even realize you're doing it.
I noticed on the live chat, some of the guys have asked, how do you deal with missed clues? Matt, how do you deal with missed clues?
I suppose it depends on the clue in question, but the big piece of advice there is, if someone has missed it, think of alternate ways to get it to the players. Don't stick with just, oh, this book is found at one location, therefore it can only be found there. Give them multiple roads to potentially find it. If they've missed it at the first library, maybe it's at a cultist house, maybe it's at a crime scene. There's more than one way of getting information to players. Don't be constricted by what you see on the page. Be quite open to be flexible with it and rewrite it if you need be.
Yeah, if your scenario hinges on a single clue or a single witness or a single item, that's not a scenario you want to publish. You need to give people a wide enough area so they can approach the end of the scenario in more than one way. Especially if you have a group that is more geared to a certain play style, like they're more pulpy. You know, they're going to find a pulpy ending. If you have a group that's more bookworms, let them have a bookworm ending. The scenario can have multiple endings suited to multiple play styles with parallel clue trails or webs of clues that weave in and out. You don't ever want a bottleneck in your narrative.
And yeah, I can see, so if as you're writing it and you're trying to come up with this flow chart, and how do you find that balance then as to, well, okay, leave this up to the GM to figure out, you know what I mean?
The other thing I say about clues and missed clues is there are certain clues in the scenario that are vital. Without the clue, it cannot go on. And what the guys have just said, that all counts. And yes, you know, multiple ways of finding that vital information. But also don't forget, you don't have to make people roll for every bit of information. If it's a vital core clue, an obvious clue, then just give it to them. Just, you know, they've arrived, they've looked at the book, this is the clue. They've spoken to the person, this is what they say. You don't need to, it doesn't have to be a random chance all the time for them to find it. There are clues where you want, you know, that you want to kind of use dice rolling for and that kind of thing, and that's all cool. But there are normally, you know, one or two clues that are kind of vital for the scenario. Mm-hmm. Don't make people roll for them. What happens if they don't get it? They're in the right place, they're looking at the right thing, but they miss their roll. Don't get into that situation. Let them have the core clue. And in terms of writing the scenario, be clear what are the core clues and what are periphery stuff that they, if they don't get it, it doesn't really matter, that kind of thing. And say it in the scenario. Say, this is vital, they get the information. Give it to the players, do not make them roll for you. Tell the give the keeper a hand and tell them what, you know, what your intention is when you wrote the scenario.
I noticed, since I'm running Horror on the Orient Express, that you very nicely put throughout the entire thing places where the characters could go completely off track or break the scenario, and you give warnings as to, you know, how to deal with that. It's very helpful.
Yeah, I think at the end of the day, you know, part of writing a scenario is not only writing, you know, the plot that was in your head and putting it onto paper, it's also writing how you kind of trying to get people to play it in terms of, you know, how do you intend people to run the scenario? And obviously, as Oscar said, you know, some groups are going to go a more pulpy way, others are going to go a more kind of hardcore, straight edge way. And that's fine, because that, you know, the game encompasses all those kind of different elements, and the game mechanics handle that. But in terms of, you know, your intention is, you know, this scene, my intention is it's going to be a big reveal. So I want to signpost that to the reader, to the guy running it. So, you know, be clear, you know, don't, one of the bugbears of scenario writing is the writer is, there's a kind of a twist coming, but they don't tell the keeper there's a twist until the twist happens later in the scenario. Tell them up front, tell them at the beginning, this scenario is about a twist, because then they understand what you're trying to do with the scenario.
They often start by saying, read the entire scenario before you start.
Yeah, that helps as well.
and it's surprising how many people don't, because, you know, and then they'll try to change things as they're playing the game and suddenly realize they've screwed themselves.
I killed this major NPC that's vital to the end of the scenario.
Yeah.
One thing I'd like to throw in there about how to not derail, you know, how to not lead everybody into a dead end is, and again, about giving clues, there's a saying that every home run is a pitcher's mistake. In my head, every time the investigators have a chance at stopping the mythos, it's because someone made a mistake. Some cultist made a mistake. The monster got sloppy. They left a witness alive. They dropped a vital piece of information. You cannot make your villains Moriarty, because if you make your villains Moriarty, only Sherlock Holmes can solve them, can beat them. Your villains are not perfect. They're not supposed to be. If they were perfect, they would do what they're doing, and investigators would never get a sniff that anything was going on. So again, keeping in mind that they are not perfect, that they made a mistake somewhere, you can give clues without rolling. You know, you can have things be obvious. You can get the investigators on their trail because somehow they made a critical mistake at some point. I think once you kind of get that, it becomes a lot easier to manage the flow of the narrative. Because we all want to think our villains are super villains and infallible, and they're not. They should never be.
They need to be definitely limited by the realm of physics that we live in. They can't know things that they can't know. They can't, you know, just because they're cultists around doesn't mean that the cultists are aware of your presence, you know, unless they have some physical reason to be aware of your presence. And
absolutely. you as a games master have to decide whether Neelapatep is omnipotent or not. does it see everything or not? You know, if he's involved in, or it is involved in your scenario, but for humans, Oscar said, right, you know, they make mistakes, and that's what player characters normally capitalize on. I just wanted to pick up on one thing. Dale on the live chat was asking about how you nudge players back onto the plot if a vital clue is missed, and we've kind of answered that to some degree, but what happens if you did, you know, kind of screw up a little bit and they've not gone that way? That's what the idea role is for in Call of Cthulhu. That is exactly what the idea role is for. And that allows both the players and the keeper to actually give them that core clue that they miss somehow. And the whole idea role is they make the idea role If they succeed in the role, they get given that clue. If they fail the role, they get given that clue, but they get given it in some dire circumstance, perhaps. It's not, you know, they find that find them land themselves in a little bit more trouble, perhaps, in realizing that clue. But that's what the idea role is exactly for. If you've really gone off the rails and you want to get them back on track, that's what an idea role is for.
I also like to think that a competent NPC, you know, kind of the opposite end of the idea rule is a competent NPC can show up, you know, if you're doing a murder case and you guys, the players are private investigators trying to solve something, a detective on the police end can then share that information because the detective is already working on the case because it's a murder case. The cops are going to be involved. So I think that creating competent NPCs is just as important as having your players come up with competent characters.
Yeah.
That's always a bit of a worry for me. It's a great method of getting information to the players, but it's a fine line to walk between that and Deus Ex Machina, because it can sometimes come across that you've got a piece, and suddenly the NPC turns up and says, info. It's like, oh, okay, other people out there have got either better than us, or they've got more information than us, and it kind of almost puts the limelight a bit more on them than it does on the PCs. It's certainly a valid technique to use, but you have to be very careful as and when you do it, just in case you don't outshine the main PCs, which should be the core of the game.
Yeah, it could give you the impression that you're just pushing them along a storyline that they're not really having any, their interactions don't really mean much to the story. They're just going to be there for the story to play out.
And there is one other way to handle this if all of that fails. Let them fail. This is Call of Cthulhu. Sloppy role play, manhandling a key witness, ignoring an obvious storyline, mismanaging your time when you're on a time-sensitive scenario. Not every adventure has to end in a happy ending and all of the investigators solving the scenario. Sometimes that sacrifice is gonna die, and all you're gonna do is find their dead body 2 days later. And you dock them sand and you make them live with that and you go on. You can have every, I was reading on a thread recently that everybody was, all of my investigators, they got so intimidated, they just stopped playing and they never fought the monster at the end. And everybody was like, oh my God, that's terrible. And I'm like, that's a win. That's even better than killing every investigator. You've scared them so badly. They like, they pulled a Cartman. We call it the Cartman option in my game. Screw you guys, I'm going home. And to me, that's the opposite of TPK. We call it ICL, I choose life. They're not gonna win everyone, and they shouldn't. I guess I'm lucky. When I first started playing Call of Cthulhu, I played with a brutal keeper, and I died or failed my first 5 games. and it was great. And it didn't turn me off. It made me want to do better.
We've discussed doing an episode about what we call player GM etiquette, because we're aware that we're playing a game, and a lot of times when we're playing with brand new groups who've never played Call of Cthulhu before, they don't know how to play the game. In the sense, they might have the mechanics down, but every time something happens, they want to run to the police. And it's like, okay, you can do that, but it's not much of a game if you keep doing that. You know, a
couple of nights in the drunk tank will cure them of that right away.
I had a game recently with a group of guys who'd never played Call of Cthulhu before, who had been longtime D&D players. They wanted to give it a go, so I ran a game for them, and they did pretty well. It was a great game, and it came to the end. They didn't really solve the mystery. They kind of mainly ran away with, you know, bleeding and half dead, but just kind of made it out alive, and ran into the arms of the police. So I said, well, the police are going to question you about what happened. So, you know, what's your story? Do you want to take a moment and decide what you want to tell them? You know, hinting heavily that, you know, maybe they want to kind of fabricate a story to not implicate themselves. But no, they just told the truth and said, no, we have to shoot the person we were looking for because they turned into a monster and we had to put him out of his misery. And so when I explained to them that they'd all been arrested and were charged with murder, they were looking at me blank-faced. But we told the truth. Yeah, but the cops just admitted to murder. Why? That's all the cops heard. They don't really know what you're talking about, monster. That doesn't compute. You just claimed you've murdered this well-to-do guy. So I'm afraid you are facing murder charges. And then the penny dropped, and they were like, "Oh, of course, it's not fancy land. These are real police. They will, look into things."
I have a very similar story that I want to follow up on, but from the opposite end, something very similar with very experienced players. I had a large group of seven, and they were playing a scenario, and they got to the possible end. They could walk away, or they could go on to the bonus round and fight the big bad. They didn't have to. And one of the seven said, "I'm not going." And the others are like, "You're a coward. We have to do this." And he goes, "No, I don't. I'm going home." And he went home. The other six went out into the spooky woods after the big bad. Long story short, one of them woke up the next morning surrounded by the dead bodies of their five compatriots. I mean, it was a total bloodbath. And that one person was like, "Oh my God." And one of the players of the dead characters said, "Well, what are you going to tell the police about all this?" And her reply was, "You assume I'm going to tell the police anything about this." And the one guy who had left, he said, "Meanwhile, I'm having a bubble bath, sipping some Chardonnay." And he goes, "says, I don't seem like such an idiot now, do I, guys?" And it was like, it was the opposite. It was like the seasoned investigators, and they were just like, "Screw this! I'm not telling the cops anything. I'm making sure that my fingerprints and tracks are nowhere near this crime scene, and I'm sneaking away."
One trick I've used when the PCs have pulled that inevitable "we call the police" card is use that as a seed into a different scenario. Actually, there's something really messed up and fucked up in the police force that now you've got to deal with that problem as well. But now this has just added another level of complication to you.
That's awesome.
Oh, I've sent people to prison.
I had a great campaign a few years ago in which all the characters, it was set during the Depression, and all the characters were hobos. And that removed so many of the options of the characters. They couldn't go to the police. They couldn't go to the authorities because they were already mistrusted by the authorities. In many cases, they couldn't even go into a library because the librarian's not going to let a bunch of hobos go into their library.
Right.
So it really forced them down a different path. But certainly in dealing with the police and railroad bulls. No, they weren't someone that those characters would turn to. They had to fend for themselves. That was quite an interesting experiment.
Yeah, I mean, it's what you did there. I mean, one of the particularly for convention scenarios is that kind of sense of isolation. So it is just the PCs; they've got no one to turn to. Mm-hmm. And normally, the traditional way has been to kind of put them in an isolated location, such as I don't know, a submarine or a lighthouse on an island off the middle of nowhere. But equally, you can do it in the middle of a city if you place it right, as you did with having them as hobos or whatever.
Social isolation. Yeah.
So the question came up before from Jeff, talking about, well, I've got it written here about balancing the game and what I and combining that with what Dale is asking on the chat room. When you're coming up with a game, how do you really gear it towards, let's say, beginners or advanced people? How do you know whether you're going to be making a 2-hour scenario or a 30-hour scenario, campaign? Do you know that beforehand? Is that what you attempt to do, or is that just what it turns into as you go along?
I think. For me, in what I do, I know what I'm going to do before I do it. So I know I'm writing a convention scenario that can only work in 1, 2, or 4 hours, or it's a, you know, a standard scenario that might run for one session, maybe go to four sessions, depending on how, you know, the style of play of the group, or I'm doing a campaign or part of a campaign. So I kind of have that set in mind to start with, because I mean, writing a campaign is to some degree is quite a different process to writing just a single scenario. It's not a great difference, but there are some things you have to obviously take into account. So I kind of tend to sort of go in knowing what I'm writing. Often, you know, if I've just come up with an idea for a scenario, I'll go at it as if it's a single scenario. Then as I'm writing it, if I find this is bigger than what I thought it was, and it's growing, then suddenly I might consider that actually this is maybe 2 or 3 scenarios. This is maybe a small campaign or something. But I tend to find that when I'm writing it rather than before. But in the main, I know what I'm writing before I start writing it, almost, because I've got a certain book I want to do, and therefore that's what I want to write to. I guess you're the same, Oscar. Are you?
If you're going out to write a one-shot convention scenario, you've really got to keep in mind as you're writing that this is a one-shot convention scenario, because the ideas will run away from you, and suddenly you've got a 6, 12, you know, 18-hour game, and it's no longer a convention scenario. So it's actually pretty hard to write a convention scenario, because it's 3 hours and 45 minutes of gameplay. It's got to be a very tight, very quick, controlled narrative that doesn't feel like a railroad, but is solvable in that time. A lot of the longer things that I've written were started out supposed to be one shot, and the idea just got away from me. The Legacy of Arius Lurko, which was a campaign, started out as a one long, 1 or 2 session scenario. It turned out to be, you know, 4 scenarios, each one taking about, you know, 12 hours of gameplay. It just got away from me, and I let the muse take me. But if you're really setting out to write something in a controlled way for a specific amount of time, you have to be cognizant of that while writing and restrain yourself from, you know, exploring everything that's interesting and all the possibilities, because then, you know, then you don't have a 3 hour and 45 minute scenario. Then you've got 16 hours of gameplay, which is great, but it's not what you plan to do. And if you're running a con, if you're running at a con in 3 weeks, you're screwed, because now you've got nothing.
When just to the form of meter, when you talk about a session, what do you guys think a session is? 4 hours, 6 hours? Because, often our scenarios that we'll say, it'll say this will be 2 sessions, and we'll worry about it taking long. But see, our games last 2 hours a week, so yeah, it ends up being eight weeks long instead of.
What about you, Matt?
Depends if I'm running on the last session of last session of the day at a convention or not. Sometimes they can be 8 hours long. Going back a little bit to the point about the scenario design, because I think this kind of fits in to that answer as well. That when I design a scenario like a one shot, for example, I'll just write down what I think the story should be. I'll play test it through a couple of times, think, right, around this length, maybe I can trim this bit, this scene isn't needed, ditch that, and start rearranging it so it fits the time scale where I'm going to be running it. So if I know I'm going to be running it at a particular length in a convention, then I'll cater it to that length. If it's somewhere where time isn't an issue, like around a friend's house or insert other location here, then I'll let it run as long as it needs to go and as long as people are enjoying it. But yeah, it's just being able to know what to trim out and where to trim.
Yeah.
As for like a regular session length, because I do conventions so much, is that it's generally turned into 3 to 4 hours. That's kind of the default length of a session for me.
For me,
so everything kind of in that time scale.
For me, it would be 4 to 6 hours would be a session, depending on when we start and, you know, how everybody's feeling, if we break for a meal. Anything over 6 hours, if you're over 30 years old, it's... It's painful to sit that long. I remember my teen years, I could sit and play D&D for 11 hours straight. I don't want to do anything for 11 hours now, no matter what it is. So yeah, I would say 4 to 6 hours is good for a session.
And when you say session, does that equate to a scenario?
No. Some scenarios will take 2 or 3 sessions long. Anything more than 3 sessions of play should be broken up into multiple scenarios. If you've got a scenario that takes more than 12 hours to finish, you need a part 1 and part 2. It's just my opinion. It's so hard to get a group of people together.
Yeah.
And you know, so anything beyond that should be broken up into multiple scenarios.
I imagine too, during a convention, you have to in some way cut off the players, because we're notorious. Our players are notorious for going to lunch and dinner in the scenarios and just role playing. They love to role play, but that can extend a scenario from a 2-hour scenario to a 12-hour scenario eventually. Yeah, I imagine that in a convention you've got to really cut that off.
You have. I mean that because you're no longer playing the scenario, you're playing your role playing, and that's fine because that's what you want to do as your group. But you no longer actually while you're role playing lunch, you're kind of not really doing the scenario anymore, which is fine if that's what you as a group want to do. But as you say, but in a convention scenario, you have to just cut to the chase. You've just got to cut. I treat it like a TV episode. So what are the key scenes that need to happen to make this scenario successful? They're the ones that are going to happen. You know, once the players have decided what they want to do, then we cut to that scene. If the players are taking far too long and going for lunch in the middle of a con scenario, then the scenario will come and find them. You know, it will burst through the doors of the restaurant and point a gun in their face or whatever it may be, and it will find them, because I've got to finish this to a satisfactory conclusion for the players in the limited time slot. But in terms of, for me, what a session is, it depends. If it's online, probably 2 hours maximum, maybe 2.5 hours maximum, because I think anything after that online, you just switch off, or somebody's switching off in the group. At home, normally 3 to 4 hours. Again, it depends. It depends on your group. You know, I've got a group I've been playing with for over 30 years, and we probably play for about 2.5 hours when we get together, because by the time everyone's got there, and then no one wants to be too late going back because everyone's going to do real jobs in the morning, you know, and that's fine. It depends on your group. And in terms of play times for scenarios, I think it's really hard to, you can only assume what you do, but you can't assume that everyone else does that. So there's a lot of scenarios that I would consider are one session scenarios that I've seen online. People have been playing them for like 6 or 8 sessions and loving it, but that's their play style. But maybe their characters are going off to lunches and role playing those as well, which is cool. But you know, if I was running it, I wouldn't take that long. But you know, you've got to play to the style and timing and pace of your group. So you know, I've seen this all the time. I see, you know, what I consider a 4-hour scenario taking 18 or more hours to do, and the players can be like, that was brilliant, we had a great time, well, I'm really glad you did, but that's not how I would have run it. Everyone's down to how they want to run it themselves, so that's cool.
I think the only problem with that is when you're at cons. If you're at a con, that table belongs to someone else after that 4-hour slot. So it's kind of a social contract that this group is going to be done in that 4-hour time slot, because otherwise they're going to inconvenience the flow of the game floor. So there's definitely some con etiquette there. You know, if your players are just dragging their feet and in 4 hours they're only halfway through the scenario, I think as a keeper, when you get to the 3-hour mark, you have to just step out of the narrative and say, look, guys, we've got to finish this up in 1 hour. You can play it however you want, but when the hour ends, we're done here. Right. I mean, if that doesn't snap them, if that doesn't get them, you know, moving, then in 4 hours, they're done. You know, you can't be those guys that are going to inconvenience and be obnoxious on the con floor.
The other thing I think you mentioned at the very start of this question, I think we've all avoided answering it, was about is there a difference between writing for beginners as opposed to experienced players? And there is a difference. And the main difference is if it's specifically for beginners, then you'll be adding in a lot more advice to the keeper. You'll be a lot more hand-holding. However, having said that, when you're writing a scenario, you should ensure that it's got all the advice and hand-holding it needs anyway. But with beginners, you may want to kind of add more. That would be how I differentiate between the two.
And for beginner players, you want to write or at least run something that has very low peril, that they're not all going to die if they mess this up. And that it's kind of a slow boil, that it builds up to let them get the feel of investigating without just slapping them around. There are scenarios that are really good for beginner groups and keepers, and there are scenarios that I would not advise anybody who's not been doing this for quite some time to try. They're great scenarios, but they are not beginner scenarios by any means.
I know where else is coming, but I don't completely agree. I think it comes down to knowing your players. If you know the players, you think that actually playing the haunting and having them all wiped out at the end is fine, and they enjoy it, then that's great. If you feel that the players are completely novice, and I think not obviously it's right that you want to try and maybe have some sort of some way that they kind of finish successfully, even if it's not a major success, they find some sort of success at the end of the scenario. But I also agree, I also would say that it doesn't have to be a mystery. It doesn't have to be an investigation. Cthulhu is traditionally an investigative game, but it doesn't have to be. It could be a horror film. It could be Survive the Night. It can be those things as well. And they often work very well for beginner scenarios because people understand what a horror film is. They understand what they're supposed to do in a horror film. They may not understand what they need to do to be a bit like Sherlock Holmes. I would say, you know your players. What are they looking for in terms of a beginner game?
Yeah, I'd say particularly with when you're saying about riffing off that it doesn't have to be an investigative game. If you are sticking with the traditional method of it being investigative, because that's what a lot of the scenarios are, then make it a very simple structure, like A leads to B leads to C, not that you've got multiple options going off. Have it a very simple 1, 2, 3, 4 in a row that you don't have to worry about having to remember stuff from the start. You've constantly got in mind what's fresh about the previous clue that you've got, but that's leading you on, driving you on. So it's something simple for the keeper to read and for the investigators to follow if they've not played an investigative game before. Keep it simple.
Yeah.
Do you ever find a benefit of writing it backwards? Do you ever write the ending or think of the ending first and then?
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, each scenario is different and we all write scenarios differently. So some scenarios will start with an ending because that's what the idea you've got is like, wouldn't it be great if it all ends with them stood there around this massive hole in the earth and, you know, whatever it is, the idea you have, and you start with the ending and you work backwards. Other times it will be a character or a location or a piece of history or an event, or this is a really foul plot and that's my idea. So it can be anything, but yes, the answer is, yeah, you can start with an ending and work backwards. Mm-hmm. But I don't always think that's necessarily the easiest way to do it because you can get yourself in knots trying to get to the ending you want to get to and find that's just not that workable sometimes.
I try never to even imagine what the ending is going to be. I try to usually write the situation. And whatever ending the players get to is fine with me. I think if I really focus on what my ending is, then whether I know I'm doing it or not, I'll probably end up writing a railroad to force my players into that ending. So I think envisioning your ending is something writers will eventually learn to try not to do, because it's not your ending. It's their ending. It's the player's ending. You're the situation. You're the challenge. You're not the narrative. They're the narrative. They've got to map this story out. You know, this is their story to tell. So if you think, well, I'm going to start with this ending, you've already funneled them into where you want them. You should just write the scenario and watch, like a puppet. Like a puppet master watching an anthill.
Yeah, I don't completely agree with that. I think you can have an ending in mind that helps you write the scenario. It doesn't. I think you're right that in terms of, you know, it may not necessarily happen that way or happen at all, because obviously once any scenario hits players, it can go 100 different million ways than you intended. But I think you can still write a scenario with from the idea of an ending. Or the idea of a particular outcome. The outcome may not be achieved by certain groups, but it might be achieved by other groups. But again, that comes down to how you write your scenarios, in the fact that, you know, you shouldn't have one ending for your scenario. There should be, you know, there should be guidance at the end of the scenario for the keeper saying, well, it could end in a number of ways. Here are some of the ones I thought of to give the keeper some guidance and some sense of how do they close a scenario. You can't just not have an ending, because otherwise, how does the keeper know when the scenario's ended, or let alone the players? So you have to imagine the ending, and you have to kind of, you know, develop it in some way. But obviously, Oscar's right, you don't want to railroad anyone through a scenario anyway. But perhaps, as Matt said, if it's a bunch of beginner players who've maybe never role-played before, then perhaps you do want to railroad them through the scenario, because they need to understand the experience of it. But again, it comes down to, what are you writing?
Yeah, a railroad is very comforting to new players.
I think what it is that you don't want to write for the ending. You want to envision the ending, but you don't want to write a scenario for an ending. It's like a Twilight Zone episode.
Yeah.
If you write for the ending, everyone's going to see it coming, because by knowing the ending and writing an entire scenario for that ending, you're putting things in place so that the ending will happen, and then everyone's already expecting it. Because if they're observant enough, they're going to predict, oh, this is what's going to happen. So it's much not less, for me at least, not railroading. It's, I want it to be somewhat open-ended. Yes, envision it, because you want an idea of what's going to happen in the end. But you also want the players to be like, I don't know what's going to happen. There's so many things that could happen. I don't know what happens when I stand at the edge of the hole in the earth. Is something going to come out? Am I going to fall in? What's going to happen? So I don't think writing for an ending should be what you want to do. I think envisioning the ending is good, but writing for an ending is just going to hinder the writing process in the long run.
I think we're coming at it as slightly different. It's the terminology, the language that we're using, that actually using a common language with different meanings. Because what I thought we were talking about is what ideas help you to write a scenario. And an idea that you have about an ending can help you to write a scenario. I'm not saying that you write the scenario to that ending. I'm saying the idea of the ending helps you to create the scenario. That's what the discussion's about. Not, you know, at the end, they will be stood at this point. They will do this thing and they will do that. No one's going to write that. That's right. Completely mad. But we're talking about the concept of how scenarios are constructed, and you can take an ending and use that as a springboard to then develop a scenario from it. It may end up, you will probably find 99.9% of the time that the idea you started with never happens in your scenario, because that was what springboarded you into writing the scenario. That's kind of what I'm trying to say.
Yeah. Coming at it from a different angle, how I would say is you don't necessarily envision the end scene, but maybe think of it as envisioning what would happen if the bad guy got their way, and how could the players try and stop it. Because then you're thinking about it from, the players could do X, Y, or Z. They could approach it from different angles, and any one of those could result in your final scene and will be very different depending on what angles they've chosen. So one thing I've tended to do more recently is present numerous options of how it could be written, how it could come to a conclusion based on player action, and approach it in that sense.
Yeah, I think that's a really good tip, Matt, is that, you know, providing the poor old keeper with some possibilities and ideas of how, you know, what might happen if this doesn't happen or this does happen is I think is really good scenario writing. I think that because what a scenario is a bunch of advice to a guy who's got to run it for some other guys and gals. You know, providing that guidance and ideas and inspiration is what you want to give the keeper. You know, it's not set in stone. We all know that. But providing that range of different paths throughout the scenario, you know, there's a kind of at the start, there's kind of, here's how they start. Here's some advice of the ways they might go. Middle of the scenario, they've got to this point, probably they should know this kind of stuff. Where can they go now? Where they could go this way, potentially. And the same at the end, you know. So they've got to this point. Here's how they might tackle the ending kind of thing. And that, for a keeper, I find is really good, really useful, because your players are going to be in one of those strands or near to one or completely off the chart perhaps, but at least you've got some way of, you know, using that information to pull the scenario together.
Yeah, I think I once read that in some cases, of course, since you're dealing with the Cthulhu mythos, the inevitability of the disaster at the end is there. It's just a matter of whether your players manage to delay it or postpone it. Or just, you know, heroically sacrifice their lives to just delay it a little bit, which is, I think, awesome.
Sure.
No hope of defeating Cthulhu or Nyarlathotep, but maybe screw up his plans for a few minutes.
Can I jump in with one of our chat questions from Simon?
Sure.
I thought he had a good one where he was asking, how do you know how many times you should have a scenario play tested? Is it just like a piece of artwork where you feel, okay, yeah, this is as good as it's going to get, so.
I mean, the more, at the end of the day, the more playtesting that you can do helps. But like writing anything, whether it's a scenario, a novel, a short story, or whatever it is you're writing, it's never finished. It's never finished because you will always want to go back and twiddle with it and do things. But you have to get it to a point where you can walk away. And you go like, I think I've got it down. I know it works because I play tested it. I was giving it to somebody else and they told me that they ran a really great game with it and they had no questions after the game. So therefore, I think it works for other people. So I can walk away. But no piece of writing is really ever finished for a writer. You mean you finish something and you pick up the printed book of it and you look at it and you go like, oh yeah, I'd probably change that now. I'd do this differently. Or, you know, it's, every writer, I'm pretty sure, feels the same. You just gotta play test it till you think you've done it enough. And the best way to know you've done it enough, as I say, is give it to somebody else. And if they come back and they have got no questions, and they say it ran perfectly, we enjoyed it, and you know, and then tell you, share the stories of what they did, you kind of think, well, I think I've done it, man. I think I've done it. So that would be my advice. If you're not sure, give it to somebody else and let them tell you.
Well, and playtesting is something that you're going to do when your aim is to publish the scenario, right?
Yes.
Right.
So that could bring up the question of how do you convert a homebrew into a publishable scenario? Mike, what would you accept if somebody was going to send it to you? Would you read through it or would you playtest it before you publish?
I haven't got time to play test scenarios that I'm not going to publish. But I will try and read them, or I'll start reading them. And if after the first page it's clear that it's not a publishable scenario, then I'll stop reading and I'll probably give some notes and scan the rest of it to provide some notes to the writer. But let me think. Turning a homebrew scenario into a publishable scenario is dotting all the I's and T's, because your shorthand or your bullet points that you wrote for yourself have now got to turn into full paragraphs and sentences that actually explain the things to somebody else. And so, you know, my advice is, if you're not sure, then open a published scenario, a relatively modern one, not one written 30 years ago, but open something that, you know, Oscar or I or Matt or whatever have put out, and just compare the two. You know, does it have an introduction? Does it explain what scenario is? Does it have, you know, does it have the, you know, the structure through it? Is there a narrative flow that explains it? And if there isn't, then try and use, you know, find a scenario that you like that's published and try and, you know, use that as a template for yours, and, you know, just pour yours into the template and try and do it that way, perhaps. It's there's no easy answer. It's experience and giving it a go is the way to do it. You give it a go and you get some advice and you get some feedback from people.
The major piece of kind of bolt one I'd give to that is be fairly mercenary with your editing. Once you've got the whole thing written up and you've done your first draft and you've play tested it through, I personally play test things through between half a dozen to a dozen times with ideally different groups, so that I can show what different people, how they attack it, what their thoughts are, what their processes are. And maybe after, if three or four times happen in a row where fairly similar things happen or there's no new player action that comes into it, I think, right, I've got what mostly the player action could be. If you've got something written in your manuscript that no player's ever gone near, don't be afraid to ditch it, because probably you're going to be working to a fairly tight word count, and you need to be very concise about getting over the information to the keeper in the most succinct fashion they can, so that they're not reading a whole lot of fluff, that they're not trying to delve amongst some very nice elaborate prose to get to the core of what they're supposed to be doing. Because it's almost like writing a technical manual at some point. It can be very technical writing, that you are trying to write a very functional piece as well as get a story across at the same time. So it can be quite a difficult line to walk. But yeah, be mercenary with your editing.
There's one other trick. Come up with a really blow away idea. Come up with an idea that's so innovative, so original and so awesome, that even if your prose style isn't quite up to scratch for publication, you blow, you know, the reader, the editor away. They might go, actually, your ideas are so cool that I want to publish this. I will help you. I will work with you and mentor you or whatever to, you know, to get you up to scratch. But just having the idea alone isn't enough. You do still need to be able to kind of convey that idea in a reasonable way in your writing. If you can do that, then obviously you're on the good start of the road. You know, you've got a good way ahead. You know, just having the idea alone and saying, "Hey, Mike, I've got a really cool idea," it's fine. So everyone's got ideas. It's whether you can turn that idea into something written that will convey that idea to somebody else. That's the key.
One of the difficulties I've faced, because I've tried to write a number of scenarios, I've never actually succeeded, is I'm very self-conscious of other stories and things that I've read. And I find that if I'm writing this and it's too similar to that, then I avoid it. And I sort of sabotage myself as I go along, you know, because...
Yeah, I can understand. Yeah.
And I've been told that, you know, just because somebody else wrote something doesn't mean that you can't write it better. But I still, the problem is plot lines. There's so many plot lines. And of course, we're dealing with Call of Cthulhu. So everybody going into it knows there's going to be something at the end that's twisted and the monsters are trying to take over the world and whatever. But it's hard to come up with a new idea, at least.
Isn't it, you know, it was, I can't remember the line, isn't it? Good writers steal. No, good writers copy, great writers just steal.
And, yep. And authenticity, its originality its originality is non-existent. Authenticity is invaluable. So, yeah.
Just... It's There are, you know, there are lots of ideas out there, but a lot of them are very similar. You know, there's, you know, and we're talking about a specific genre of a specific game that's, you know, about a specific type of thing. And so there's a lot of similar ideas out there. But don't let that hold you back. Because, I mean, the trick in writing is to write. The more writing you do, the better you will hopefully get. And even if you start and you're just basically, you find, actually, I've just written the plot to the thing for Call of Cthulhu, fine. It may not get published, that one, because it might be too close. But it might be that you started writing the plot to the thing, and actually you ended up somewhere completely different. And actually, hey, you've created something new, different. It starts in a very similar way, but ends completely somewhere else. That's really cool. Don't let what you feel is a lack of an originality stop you from writing. Write, because the more you write, you'll find your own voice, and you'll start to have your own ideas as well. You know, a lot of fiction writers, you just keep to, you know, Lovecraftian fiction. You know, a lot of Lovecraftian authors started out writing pastiches of Lovecraft. You know, you read them and, you know, they're trying to be Lovecraft. And over the years, they've developed their own voice, their own stories. But the only way to do that is to write. So don't let that hold you back.
Everyone's a hack for their first five scenarios. you just accept it. Don't worry if it's similar to another story. Just write your story. Yes, it is similar to that story, but this is my story. This is what I did, and I love it. And if it turns out it's not that good, that's fine, because you've done it and now you can move on.
Yeah.
And now you can do something else. And if you look at it 10 years later, you know, and you're like, oh my God, what the, I was blessed enough to get to rewrite Ripples from Carcosa for 7th edition release after it was a 6th edition monograph. And let me tell you, I was horrified. I said, please give me 3 months to rewrite this crap before anyone else sees it. And I was really proud of it when it came out, and I'm still proud of it. But wow, did I learn a lot in 10 years of writing for Call of Cthulhu. And the things I'm writing today, I hope 10 years from now I can look at it and say, wow, this is crap. Please let me rewrite it. I'm much better now than I was then. And that should be every writer. Every writer should always be striving to improve upon what they've done. You know, a life well lived is a life of growth. You're never going to stop growing as an author. You're always going to be striving to do better. If you're self-conscious and you're just starting out and you're like, oh my God, this is a ripoff, this is crap, I'm a hack, that's fine. You're starting out. We all started out, and we all started out in a very similar place. You just got to do it and you get through it.
That's really encouraging.
The question I get asked quite a lot is, how do you become a writer? And the answer is really easy. You have to write, because a lot of people want to be writers, but they don't write. And, you know, so as Oscar said, just write. Just write. It may be complete drivel. It doesn't matter. You will get better.
Everybody wants to be a rock star. Nobody wants to go to band practice. Everybody wants to be a published author. Nobody wants to write five crappy scenarios that steadily get better until you can get published. I have people all the time say, how do you do this? And I say, send me a scenario. Write me something, send me a scenario, I'll critique it. I did that for 5 years. You know how many people actually sent me a scenario? One. And I'm proud. I have an apprentice now, and I'm helping him get his, you know, get his act together, and I hope to publish him eventually. But seriously, at least 12 people have asked me that question for years, and I've said, send me something and I'll critique it. That's how I got my start. You know, I got a mentor. I wanted to do this. I kept writing, and then someone took notice and had pity on me and you know, sent me an email and taught me how to write scenarios. But you've got to just keep hammering away. you know.
Dale Jennings is asking about your favorite kinds of clues to use, and it comes up with one of these other questions. Is Jeff was asking me the other day, how do you feel about using a lot of visual aids? I mean, you've got newspaper clippings and things like that, but what about, you know, just pictures of the characters or pictures of the monster? Or do you like using them, or do you like leaving that all up to the imagination?
I love that stuff, but I can't do it. I don't know. I don't have the time or the technical skills or the artistic expertise to really do wonderful props. I'm in awe of people who can do wonderful props, and I love playing their games, and I see their props online, and I'm like, man, that's cool. I can't do that. The most I can do is, you know, soak something in coffee and dry it in the oven to give it an aged effect, maybe burn the edges with a lighter. But I mean, that's, you know, that's like 12th grade handouts. So my favorite clues are dramatic interplay between witnesses and the investigators. You know, a witness who's in pain, who's suffering, lost, afraid, hiding something, being blackmailed. You know, when they speak to that person, and they slowly, through conversation, unravel what they want to say but are trying not to. To me, that's magical. You know, that interpersonal, that interpersonal exchange between NPCs and witnesses and you know, victims or whatever. That's a personal thing. So my personal thing will be the dramatic NPC reveal during interrogation, or the villain monologuing when you've stumbled upon the evil lair. But yeah, I like people.
Well, I normally have a villain turn up in a game and it monologues at me. I normally shoot it by the time it gets to the end of its first sentence. one of the things I love to do is I love reoccurrence of small, little description. Something that starts off innocuous, but then as it comes up again and again, people start to suddenly hear the penny drop that actually this might be somewhat more significant, that something very mundane suddenly turns into something very much not. I can't think of any non-spoiler examples, and I'm having trouble coming up with one. So maybe, for instance, if you're writing a scenario about Kutchulatas, for example, the treader in the dust, that you start off by saying that, oh yeah, this place is a little bit dusty, someone hasn't been cleaning here for a while, or something that involves that natcha, that, oh yeah, you see a little spider crawling around in a cobweb in the corner. But yeah, little hints that start to foreshadow things, and then they grow and build as the scenario goes on. That's a trick I like to pull.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I have to say, I like both of what you guys have said. Both of those things I really like. I like the character interplay. I like, you know, at the end of the day, that's for me the core of role playing. It's, you know, I get to role play a character as well as the players, and so that's what I really enjoy doing. But equally, I do love the kind of the slow burn of these kind of accumulation of disparate information to reveal the whole. Where have you heard that before? You know, those kind of clues, you know, like, I know, I'm trying to think of an example, but what keeps coming to my head is Bad Wolf from Doctor Who, you know, this kind of phrase that has no meaning until the final, and then it kind of, oh, okay. But, I think the question also asked about, you know, other than kind of newspaper clippings and things in books in terms of handouts, what other ways can you convey information? Well, obviously the guys have just given you two, but you know, obviously there's websites and there's, you know, but what about, you know, audio recordings, maybe an MP3 there's a website that's got this MP3 on it that is some strange noise or a voice talking or a website or a telephone message or an app that does something crazy. You know, use what's around you. Everything, we live in an information age. Everything can be a potential source of information in some way. So I think, you know, they don't have to be limited to what's in the library or what this certain website says. You know, go mad, you know, it's a YouTube clip. I don't know, whatever it may be. And, you know, the YouTube clip of some guy he was a witness to some event that's not on the clip, but it's describing the clip. And then the players then go, well, we've got to go and speak to this guy. And they go and find him. And then they get the story. And then they get to see the location. He showed it to them. And I don't know. You know, you could do all sorts of things in the modern day, I guess, in that way.
Yeah, I'm fortunately a graphic artist, so I love making collateral items, yeah, too.
Louis, this may be the beginning of a beautiful friendship.
I think, though, that the question from when Jeff asked it to me was, do you think that you lose something if, let's say, I have a picture of the monster as opposed to just describing the monster and letting them see it in their
yeah, bones? I think that's a really interesting point. And I think that comes down to, I often say this, it's know your players. Certain players, I think, will really enjoy having that visual representation to really kind of solidify what you're trying to describe. Other players don't like that, and they want to treat it like the, you know, like a classic horror film where you don't really see the monster, you only get shadows, and they let their imagination fill in, because at the end of the day, your player's imagination can do a far better job than you're ever going to do drawing or describing a non-Euclidean angle and a monster. However, you know, some artists are pretty good. So, you know, I wouldn't say don't use it at the table. I think it's know your group. What's appropriate for your group? If you think that they want to see those kind of handouts, then great, use them. If they're the kind of players that, you know, and talk to them about it. Talk to them about it before the game. Find out what they want from the game. You know, if you're not prepared to find artwork, then don't have the conversation. But if you are, you want to do it, then, you know, use it. I think most players will really appreciate some form of thing. And even then, you know, if you're showing artwork of a monster, don't show all of the monster. Again, be vague, be subtle with it. Again, allow them to use some of their imagination to fill in some of the blanks.
What about tied into that? So if I were to write a scenario, and I've gone through the playtesting, I've got to the point where, okay, I'm going to show this to somebody, and I wanted to send it to you or Oscar or so-and-so, would I have to come up with the graphics and the layout ahead of time, or are you used to getting just raw text?
Don't want it laid out. Raw text, please. Because that's our job, is to lay it out. We'll do the art, yep, and all that kind of, that's our job. But what we want, as you as a writer, what we want you to do is write and not spend any of your energy on doing anything else. So your full energy goes into making that the best bit of writing you can. Same for an artist. You know, we want them to spend all their energy on doing what they're good at, which is the art bit. You know, right, the publisher pulls it together.
Yeah, we've got people to do that. We've got people who are good at maps. We've got people who are good at art. We've got people who are good at layout and making charts. Just give us a good story, and we'll take care of the rest. You know, we're ringleaders. Mm-hmm. We'll pull it all together.
Some publishers as well have particular style guides that they want scenarios submitted in a particular fashion. Like some say, I want it in raw text. I don't want any format, even formatting on the document, on the text.
Oh, okay.
Some want headings marked in a particular fashion. Others say, I want a text box to illustrate in a particular way. So, yeah, get to know what the publisher's style is as well. If you ask for a style guide, they will send you one.
Yeah, that's really important, actually. You know, if you were intending to try and get into publication, is, you know who you're writing for. You know, look at, you know, if it's, you know, as an example, as Chaosium, you know, look at what Chaosium is putting out these days. What is our style guide? What are we looking for? You know, then you stand a much better chance, rather than just not doing that and just sending something in that you're guessing that is kind of what we want to see. Because most publishers would be more than happy, as Matt says, to send you a style guide or at least give you some outline to what they're looking for.
And we'll be even more thrilled if you actually follow them. because I've sent out plenty and we still get weird stuff. So if you ask for the style guide, for God's sake, follow it. Because if you don't, it's like getting slapped in the face twice. It's like, really?
As an academic, I can sympathize with weirdly formatted submissions in green ink.
Like Arial 11 font. Really? Again? And you just, we're under enough pressure. Just follow the guides.
At least it ain't Comic Sans. That's a blessing.
Oh, my God.
No, to be honest, if it's just the font choice, that's the least of your problems. I'll forgive font choices. That's not a problem.
I know, but if you asked and we said, then do it.
I'd actually be interested in finding out what your style choices are. I'd follow them to the letter, but I like the fact that, because all I do all day long is graphic stuff, and I'm laying out catalogs and I'm laying out all this, so it's almost difficult for me to not lay it all out the way I want it laid out. But I get that. That actually makes it easy to just give you text and let you guys worry right. about.
Obviously, you're a guy that has a certain expertise in that. But while we're not asking you to lay it out and just send us a text, so once we get to the point where actually, yeah, we do want to publish this, and obviously your input is invaluable in that sense, saying that, actually, guys, what I thought about was this. We might ignore you, but it's always good to hear. Because
probably.
Actually, yeah.
Well, and of course, you've got the expertise, so you know what's going to look good and what's not going to.
And also, every company builds their brand identity. Right. Their books are laid out a certain way. They like to have certain styles of artists, if not the same artists for multiple projects. So you can kind of build up your brand identity. So, having format, it's distracting. Go ahead. Sorry.
What I was going to say is, I guess something that a lot of people would like to know, I'm not sure if you want to answer, but what kind of money can you make? Let's say you're publishing. Let's say that somebody provides you with,
You're not going to get rich.
Okay.
No, I
Keith Herber, when I started working with him with Miskatonic River Press, Keith Herber, Doc Herber, one of the golden age greats, looked to Tom Lynch and I when we first started Miskatonic River Press, and he said, well, we better be damn sure we're having a good time, because we're not going to be making any money at this. And I have never forgotten that, and it's usually been proven quite right. You really want to love what you do, because if you can buy some beer with it, great. But
Okay. Well, so I was going to say, but now as a publisher, does the writer?
I can buy a case of beer. it's no longer a six. It's now a case. It's a little more beer.
The more you do, the better you get. And if you create for yourself a position where people are buying more of your books than other authors, you may find your pay rate goes up because people want to publish your stuff because it sells more. But that's down the line a ways.
Even then,
you've got to prove yourself first, as it were.
I think the average in the UK for a successful published author, the average income is around £11,000 to £12,000 a year. So it's not not a well paid business at all.
In a more practical way, let's say I write a scenario. Let's say it's a scenario that's going to run for 5 sessions. A fairly, a nice size. Let's say like Mr. Corbett. And I have you publish it. Do I get a percentage of what you make, or do you just hand me $200 and...
It depends on the publisher and their terms. Most RPG publishers it's work for hire. So they will buy the scenario from you all in. So they buy all the rights in perpetuity from you. Other publishers may not do that. They may pay you for the right for one publication, or they may pay you royalties. Role-playing writing tends not to be in the royalty kind of situation. It tends to be work for hire or certain terms of use. It's not fiction in that sense, where you're selling the rights and then getting royalties to whatever degree. It's not the same in that sense most of the time. There are some publishers that do work like that, but every publisher is different. They all have their own different kind of terms, but most of the time, expect that once you've handed it in and you've been paid for it, that's it. It's no longer your baby. You've given birth, and now it will grow and do something else because you know, the publisher will then chop it around and edit it and add things to it, and you know, that kind of thing. You've got to let it go.
If you want to be attached to a scenario after we've paid you for it, go write another scenario. It's, you know, once it's out in the world, it belongs to the world. It no longer belongs to you.
Well, that actually brings up another one. You've written it. Let's say you've written a scenario. How do you feel about the game masters changing everything when they run your game?
Once I've written it and it's out in the world, it no longer belongs to me. It belongs to
the world.
Whoever paid to run it for their group. Once they've got it, as long as they have a good time with it, I'm fine with them doing anything they want to it. But I write a lot of scenarios. Once it's done, I'm no longer really that attached to it. I'm going to move on to the next project. And while I'm writing that project, I love it and it's mine and I'm very protective of it. But once it's done and I've play tested it a couple times and it's been through edits, I'm already like, next project. So whatever happens to it after that is kind of fine with me, as long as people are enjoying what they're doing with it. If their group is happy and the keeper is happy, fine. I'm not offended if it's changed or tweaked.
The thing I love as well is seeing what other people do with your stuff, so that when the scenario goes out there, and like we was saying earlier regarding reading actual play reports or seeing podcasts run with them, seeing what other funky twists the keeper's put in there, you're thinking, that was a really good idea. Why the hell didn't I think of that? It's a kick seeing what other people can do with it. So, I love it.
Yeah, that's a really I absolutely agree with both of the guys. It's you know, you know presumably you've role played if you're writing a role play scenario. So as part of that, you must have learned that, you know, players do all sorts of crazy things with the scenario that don't ever reflect what the scenario started out as. So knowing that going in, you kind of accept that, the players are going to just do what they like with this, and it isn't mine. It isn't mine anymore. It's theirs. It's Oscar's.
Exactly.
As Matt says, it's great when people come back and say, hey, I played your snow the night. We did this. I went, what? Wow, that's amazing. How did you get to there? Oh, we just did it. And it's like, wow, that's brilliant. You know, all you can do is inspire a group of people to have a fun time. That's what we're trying to do. We're basically writing something that hopefully inspires a group of people to have a fun experience. And how they get to that experience and what they do with it is obviously down to them. And but that's our job, is to help them have a good time.
Right. Well, one of the weirdest things that have happened in one of my scenarios is someone took the villain from one of my scenarios and transplanted them into their Knights Black Agents game, and then their Dracula dossier game, two games which I have never played, but they're like, this villain will work great from your Call of Cthulhu game in these other systems. And I'm like, I have no idea what just happened, but if you're happy, I'm happy for you. it really does go on a roller coaster once it's out in the world. And wherever it ends up, nobody will know.
I created a player character in a game that we started playing that failed. It fell apart. But that player character has been appropriated by one of my friends, who's then written stories based on that character.
Fantastic.
It's kind of flat. It's very flattering.
That's great.
Can you give us some examples of what you'd consider really well written scenarios or campaigns? Mainly because we want to make a list, too.
we want to cheat.
One, sorry, the bat, but I'll have to put the caveat on here. It's not a Cthulhu scenario, but it is a horror scenario, so you can fit this into to any stuff you come up with yourself. Mm-hmm. Jailbreak by Greg Stolze in the one-shot collection for Unknown Armies.
Matt, I was going to just say, go and buy one-shots for Unknown Armies. As a collection of well-written and well-crafted scenarios. If you want an example of good scenario writing, one shot, just as Matt is explaining. Yeah, absolutely.
Okay.
But Call of Cthulhu, it's a hard question. You're asking a bunch of publishers and writers. We all want to say ours, but...
But we're not. But we're not going to, because that would be maybe a douchey thing to do. I'll be the first one. One of my favorite scenarios of all time is Tatterdemalion by Richard Watts. It's a golden age Cthulhu oldie. If you're going to get it now and use it as an example of like how to write, it's probably 20 years out of date. But it's just, to me, that was the scenario I read that made me feel like this could be more than throwaway, that this could be an art. It's funny, and that's one of the scenarios that really made me want to write.
It's funny because I'm actually revamping that exact scenario for essentially an intro campaign for Spawn of Azathoth.
Wow. What are the odds of that? It's like funny. A moldy oldie, and we're both kind of... That's awesome.
Yeah. It is. It's a great. My thing about it is that it's structured kind of weird. I mean, I don't want to give away anything to the people here who are going to play it. But its beginning is a little kind of like, if you don't essentially kind of come up with your own introduction, it's kind of just like you're thrown in there. This is what's happening. There.
But the nature of the villain lends itself well to chaos and unpredictability. Again, just hinting, not giving anything away. It's called Tatterdemalion. Figure it out, people.
Yeah, I can't wait to run it. But it's actually coming after a homebrew scenario that sets up that scenario. So I can't wait to
play. I'm so envious. That sounds awesome.
Yeah. It's going to be awesome. I think everyone's going to really enjoy it.
I think for me, I've already said one shots, but I think for Call of Cthulhu, I think for a real, try and bring something really up to date, I think the things we leave behind, the modern anthology of scenarios that Testig and Prox put out, some really nice, tight scenarios. They're fairly mature themed, but they do have an edge. I think they all pretty much have an edge to them. I think that if someone wants to look at some good scenarios, I think there's some good ones in there. And I think going back, my golden oldie, I always go back to Mr. Corbett in Mansions of Madness. I think it's a great scenario. I'm always surprised that nobody else has done the same concept, which is basically you're looking out your house and your neighbor's doing strange things. It's just a great concept that everyone can get. Everyone can instantly be in that position. And I just think, I'm amazed that there's no other scenarios that kind of start that way. I think that's a great, great scenario.
It's one of the earliest ones that we ran and it just turned out beautifully. And it's interesting because when I first started running it, I was scared because I was afraid that the title of it is Mr. Corbett. And it's like, yeah, let's go tear his house down and see what's in his house. It's like you're pointing in the direction. So what I kind of did is I really played up the fact that these people were all sort of rich busybodies that lived in a neighborhood where nothing ever happened.
Yeah.
And so they were nosy. And, I managed to get them all divided as to, well, Mr. Corbett's always been a really nice guy living across the street. There's just no reason whatsoever to suspect him.
I was just thinking it would make a great, you know, to do it in modern day and just have it in some sort of, you know, pristine gated community somewhere where everyone's looking, their neighborhood watch is working, and I think that would be cool as well. Yeah, yeah.
So what I thought would take two sessions turned out to be, I think, a 7 or 8 session. And it was awesome.
That sounds, you just really rolled with it, didn't you?
it just was beautiful. It's one of my favorites.
Marvelous.
Can I ask one from the chat again? Dale was asking, as a writer, how do you have any tips on how to instill fear or horror as you're writing the scenario?
Be in touch with what scares you. You know, really do some self-exploration and see what draws upon your fears. You know, what are the universal human fears? And write scenario, write scenes that when you read them back to yourself, you're thinking, what the hell is wrong with me? You know, this is that you're almost revulsed by what you've put out there. You know, if you can write this with half glee and half dread that your twisted mind actually came up with that, that's a pretty good indication you've captured something that's going to scare others. But really, writing fears has to come from a personal place.
Yeah, I'd say it also depends on what you're trying to convey as the method of horror. If it's an environment that you walk into a creepy old house, then maybe suggest ways to describe things that, again, build up to create a sense of atmosphere. But the horror I tried to focus on more recently is kind of emotional horror. So to convey a particular situation and then NPC reactions to that, so that you could almost think as a player, God, what if I was in that situation, that had happened to me? That tried to make it, again, the more human impact rather than blood running down walls or monsters running around in the dark. It's, like I say, it really depends on what kind of method you're trying to use, what vehicle you're trying to convey the horror with.
Yeah, I think as Oscar says, you've got to scare yourself to be able to scare other people almost. It's kind of, you know, what scares you? Matt, friend of Matt's as well as mine, a chap called Keary Birch, used to, when he still attends conventions, but he used to walk around with this notebook, and anyone he met at the convention, he would go, "What scares you?" And then he would write it down. And then you'd sort of say to him, "What scares me is you writing that down."
Some creepy guy at the con with a notebook.
He did it for about 2 years. He had this massive list of things that people said scared them. And then he just went and took, like, what's the biggest one? Eyes was, for some reason, the biggest one. So he went and then wrote a scenario about eyes, which, you know, it was pretty effective, I have to say. But, what scares you is really important. But as Matt says, understand that horror is not one thing. There's body horror, there's psychological horror, there's the fear of isolation, the fear of being misunderstood or misunderstanding something. And all of these things, you know, try and work out what you're trying to do in the scenario. Is it about, you know, gore? Is that what it's about? So you'll describe things that will gross you out. Is it psychological? Is it playing with the player's perception? So you're giving them information that's unreliable, and the horror will come when they realize it's unreliable, and there's and the implication then that follows, that, you know, reveals it in the scenario. Understand what you're trying to do with it, and you just try and write that in. But again, tell the keeper what you're trying to do. Tell the keeper, this is what I'm trying to do. So I want you to, you know, I want the players to keep seeing this black dog in the distance. That's what I want you to do. So tell the players that's what's going to do. So when the black dog appears at the end of the scenario or in the middle, you know, launches into them or does something weird, you've got that theme running through, and the keeper hasn't ignored it because they've just said, "Oh, I didn't bother mentioning the black dog because it didn't seem important." So tell the reader in the scenario what is important. Tell them that, you know, you are trying, by keep seeing this black dog, you want to evoke this sense of menace, this strange, unnatural thing that's on the border of the periphery, wherever they look. tell the keeper that that's what you're trying to do, and that's how you partly write fear and horror into the scenario, is by, you know, telling the keeper that you're trying to do it, as well as, you know, doing it, if that makes sense.
Yeah, that's excellent.
Matthew, we had asked the question about what your favorite, your best written ones that you can think of. Did you have an answer?
My best written ones?
Ooh.
Or whatever ones you think are the really outstandingly written.
It's going to be a tough answer because the one I want to say isn't out yet. If you keep an eye out for it, one that I am very proud of is from World War Cthulhu Cold War. It's featuring in the Covert Actions collection of scenarios. It's called Cadenza, which I'm very, very proud of that. That's had a lot of really good reception when I've run it at conventions and when I play tested it, to the extent where one particular session, we had easily 2 hours of that game was once the PCs have worked out what the hell was going on and that they were left with a very nasty decision to make. We had a polarization where one side of the table was very much against the other, and it turned into a 2-hour debate that everyone at the end of the table just at the end of the session kind of just got up and gave themselves a round of applause that they liked it that much. It's definitely stuck in my mind that I'll say that's the one for me.
We haven't done a Cold War period one. We need to do one of those. That'll be fun. We've done because of Horror on the Orient Express. We've done an Invictus, and we've done a Gaslight. We've done modern ones, and we've done the 1920s, 1930s too. But we haven't really hit on the 50s or the war or anything else. So that'll be, we really need to do that.
There's a lot of messed up stuff happening in the world that you can capitalize on. And it's just so far enough removed from the modern day that you don't have to worry about investigators having pesky things like cell phones or the internet.
Yeah. On Tuesdays, I've been running at your door. And before I actually started, I thought, well, it's not that different than today, so I'm just going to make it 2016, not really realizing that it's 30 years ago. Yeah. It's like, I was suddenly like, oh my God, it's been 30 years since the 90s. And there I had to change a lot.
Yeah, yeah. I did the same thing a couple of years ago. I was rereading it, thinking I'll run this again. As I'm running it, going like, oh man, I'm really going to have to update some of the things in it to make it, you know, now is it rather right. than 30 years ago. Because it's like, yeah.
Peter like, Tate's collection of VHS tapes. And I'm like, oh crap.
Like this cultist has a 38 special.
What was the one, figuring out how to figure out from the modem where the guy had last called, and I'm like, modem?
Sure. I'm conscious that one of the questions was about breaking into scenario writing, about how to do it, and we've obviously talked a little bit about that, about, you know, people like Oscar, myself, and Destiny Worthington, Siggy and Fox, and other publishers, and, you know, we're all on Facebook, and our emails are readily accessible on our websites, and that, you know, obviously, you know, one thing you can do is get in touch. The other thing I wanted to say is that there are scenario competitions that happen. You know, I know Pagan Publishing do shotgun scenario competition every year, and other companies do similar things. And I just wanted to kind of plug, really, that we're going to be doing a convention scenario writing competition that's kind of more or less started now, actually. So you've got to be kind of a member of the Chaosium's Cult of Chaos, which is obviously a free thing to do. But we'll be running this competition, and if you sign up, you can put a pitch forward, and if your pitch is chosen, then, you know, we'll want you to go and write the scenario kind of thing, and then, you know, maybe get chosen to be an official con scenario for Chaosium, that kind of thing. But the stuff on Facebook, on my Facebook pages, and on Google and whatnot. That so you know, if you're interested, then have a look. And if you're not a member of the Cult of Chaos, then just join. It's on our website. Just fill in the box and join. It's
okay. I'm going to give your plug an additional dice for the Chaosium scenario competition. Because it's a very similar program to what the missionary program was running in the 90s when they were looking for convention scenarios. And that is where I got my start. My first published scenarios were convention competition scenarios with the Cthulhu missionaries before they were the cult back in the 90s. So if you want to cut your teeth, if you want to learn how to do this, it's a great place to start.
Cool.
I was reading through some of those guidelines on the Call of Chaos, and I noticed there were some mentions of like word counts. Is that kind of a good way to maybe judge the length of how to create a con scenario?
Yeah, I guess is a good answer. Yeah. I mean, okay. Yeah. The two reasons why there's a word count on there is one is that we don't want anyone going mad and writing 100,000 words for what should be a 3 or 4 hour scenario. You know, normally somewhere in the region of 6 to 12,000 words is enough for a convention scenario. It's not a full scenario, but people, you know, write it different ways. So, that kind of ballpark, 10K. If you can't write a con scenario in 10K or 12K, let's be generous, that's where you need to kind of gear it to. Yeah.
Okay. Really good.
And yeah. I will give a tip to the new authors. Another way that the word count is good for publishers to judge, it's to see which writers will listen and which won't. If you come in over 1,000 words, you're dead. This is basically us seeing how well you follow instructions and how easy you're going to be to work with. If the first thing you send into a publisher is drastically over word count, you have missed the point of why we put a word count in the first place. You might be tempted. Don't do it. Find the words to cut. Save yourself from yourself. Come in within the word limit.
Good piece of advice that a friend, Scott Norwood, who I work with on Blasphemous Tomes and the podcast, one piece of advice he's always given me is cut every adjective!
Yeah, the other one is, if you find yourself writing the word will, just do find and replace and delete the word will as much as you can.
This is the elements of style. I keep it right by my computer. Read this. It's less than 100 pages, and it will teach you how to cut 2,000 words out of your scenarios.
What were you saying, Mac? You got to cut.
Yeah, cut the word just as well.
Hmm. Yeah. Just. Yeah. Yeah,
yeah, the word try and avoid never essentially.
Yeah, try and avoid a passive voice. You know, make things impactful and active, if you can. But there are lots, and those books. You know, the one that Oscar just put out, The Elements of Style. There are a lot of really good books on writing. If you're serious about wanting to become a better writer, actually reading some of those books is a really useful thing to do. There's a whole range of them. You can find them on Amazon and where not. You know, even there's a good one on writing for comics, which applies equally well to writing short stories or Call of Cthulhu scenarios. It's all good advice.
Having done a pain by pain breakdown for a very short comic, about a 6-page graphic novel, boy, I envy those people. That's a lot of work that goes into some of that stuff.
Oh yeah, the graphic. How long would I guess it's completely subjective as to the writer and the length of the scenario. But how long do you think it takes to write a scenario?
Months, I think it depends. Yeah, it depends on what you're writing it for. If it's writing for yourself, then you can write I guess you could take a couple of hours and then have it done. You could take a day and have it done because you're just writing what works for you, which could be just a few bullet points and whatnot. And but for publication, I mean, Sandy Peterson always had a really good way of looking at it. He said, if I'm writing for myself, it could take anywhere from 3 hours to 3 days. If I'm writing it for a friend, probably 3 weeks. If I'm writing it for publication, it's probably 3 months. And so it's similar to me. I tend to, a couple of hours to write for myself, and then it's probably a couple of weeks to write for a friend. And then for publication, it's a month to 2 months, depending on, again, on the size of the scenario, what it is, because it could take longer. Because I'm including, I'm including the fact, you want to go through it and you want to play test it, you want to rewrite it, you want to edit it, et cetera, et cetera.
I just
it's about quality, not quantity, in that sense.
I just did the math on mine. It usually takes me 24 work hours. 24 hours of writing to produce a 12,000-word scenario. I typically am good for writing 1,500 words in about a three-hour period. After that, I'm done, and I have to stop writing until I can recharge. So I kind of did the math. So typically, it would be 24 hours of actual writing. I can get 24 hours of actual writing in around my life and day job, probably in about 2 to 3 weeks. But that's me, and I do this crap all the time.
If you look at Stephen King on writing, his book called On Writing, I think it's that one rather than Dance Macabre, is I think he suggests to new writers is every day try and write for about half an hour and then build it up to an hour and then build it up to 2 hours, depending on how much time you have.
Right.
But that's his suggestion. If you want to start writing, write for half an hour every day. It doesn't matter what you write, just write something and then go forward.
One thing that ties hand in hand with how I approach and how long it takes me to write a scenario is also how well do I know the source material that I'm looking at and how much have I researched around the topic. A topic that I think, oh yeah, this could be quite good. This is something I could get my teeth into. It could be quite interesting. Let's say using one example, actually I mentioned previously about Cadenza. I researched the RAF Akrotiri airbase on Cyprus for months and months and months to try and get it as accurate as I possibly could, so that I knew what was happening at that location, what was how did it physically get laid out, what was the purpose of various buildings, what was procedure when various stuff went down, and it was tied into a historical event. So what did actually happen at that point?
The big relief convoy?
No, it's the Turkish invasion of Cyprus.
Oh, okay.
So you can get lost in the research. I mean, I had an oil rig, and it sounds fine because it's an oil rig. It's self-contained. It's enclosed. It's all fine. It's going to write itself. The scenario writes itself, but the oil rig didn't, because as soon as you get to actually describing what locations are on a oil rig, well, the ones that I assume are on a oil rig doesn't mean that they are, and so I have to then go and really look up, structural engineering of oil rigs to work out, could the players go from here to here and here, or how's it going to work, and what's the layout going to be? And suddenly you find you've lost 2 days in research to enable you to write that bit of the scenario.
If we're including research into writing time, then my 24 hours just turned into 36. I'm just counting my non-research writing. Usually when I start writing, I've done all the research, but I would add another 12 hours onto that. Possibly even more.
If you're talking about a historical period, you really need to know what's possible. We often, when we're playing, something will come up, let's say like license plates on cars. And we'll immediately jump into, did they have license plates in 1920 and how common were they? And
depends on the state. We ran into a similar problem.
Yeah. But yeah.
It comes down to, what you're doing. If it's just for your group, it doesn't matter. You just make a call and go with it. You know, you just say, no, there weren't these things, or yes, there were fountain pens, or whatever it is you're querying historically. For publishing, then you probably want to check it out. But again, we're not looking to regurgitate Wikipedia in the scenario. Right. We are looking for what works in the scenario. So, you know, don't go over stuff and have, you know, done your homework, but don't feel you need to prove you've done your homework by putting it all in the scenario, because that's just will eat your word count and become really dull, because I'll be reading Wikipedia and not your scenario, if you see what I'm trying to say.
Yeah, I noticed that occasionally in things I'll be a little side thing that'll give you about the history of the time period.
Know what is enough, concise, you know, to the point is what we're after,
and relevant. Well,
we are approaching the 2-hour mark. Does anybody else have any questions that we haven't asked?
I have one that's probably not going to be able to be answered quickly, unless you guys can do this. I'm just curious about, so if I'm writing a scenario and I want to drop a monster in, do I need to worry about copyright as far as, does Chaosium own this monster? Does Lovecraft own that monster? Or just don't think about it?
Again, it depends. What are you writing for? Is it for publication?
For publication, yeah.
Who is the publisher?
Okay.
Work out who the publisher is and work out what is appropriate. Is it something that they're going to have a problem with in the copyright instance? So if you start using characters from Star Wars in your scenario, you can guess there's probably going to be a copyright. I'm just using it as a stupid example.
Yeah.
And be upfront with the publisher and say, look, you know, this is a scenario, but I've used this thing in it. If that will be a problem, I have this alternative solution. This is my alternative. That might be a good thing to do if you're unsure. Mm-hmm. Copyright is an issue.
Copyright, don't put Mickey Mouse in there.
but you're a writer. You can tweak it enough that it's not a copyright infringement. It's just a blatant ripoff. And then you don't get sued.
Yeah, don't be afraid to give it a new name and change its appearance and tweak a few things here and there. Make it your own.
That's what I say all the time. Is that, you know, why do you want to put this in? Just come up with something better than that, because you clearly can.
Exactly.
You can clearly come up with a better idea, even if you just add another ice stalk to it and call it.
Damn it, man! Aren't you a writer? Write something new. Create a new monster.
That's awesome.
Just going kind of from the list of questions we had pre-arranged, what are the most common problems and pitfalls you find that can effectively ruin a scenario?
I'd say one of those.
The writing of it or the running of it?
Either. But mainly, I would say mainly the writing. I mean, I think we've already covered the running of it in the first forum that we did.
Mine was more going to be my answer was more going to be geared towards running, which was tied in with do you show players the pictures of the monsters? Mm-hmm. I'd say no. That's the quick answer to that, because there's some instances where you're going to have a player that suddenly goes, oh, it's a dark young, right? Avoid bullets, hit it with fire, blah blah blah. That there's maybe an unintentional metagame aspect potentially, just describing it in a different way and not showing a categorical this is it is a way of avoiding that.
Okay. I've been in a game very much like that, yeah. Where someone said, "It's you walk into the room, there are two deep ones." Oh, great. Well, that was mysterious.
That has also a lot to do with the players. That if players are good players, then they understand that their characters don't know what a deep one is, but
you can help them though. You by not calling them deep ones and not describing them so clearly. Be vague. You know, the Lovecraftian mythos is vagueness. It's not cohesive. It's not canon. There's nothing joining it together. It's all madness. And you know, Lovecraft didn't join it together. Neither should you. And every deep one doesn't have to look like the other deep one. You know, right. Be vague.
I think Simon, who's been typing in some questions, we were playing last night, and he said, well, it's obvious it's a seaside village that we're in, so deep ones are going to be here somewhere. And it's like, no, you're not allowed to do that. That's just ignore the fact that, you know, your character doesn't know that.
We have the motto, if it's the first thing you expect, it's the last thing we're going to do.
Right.
So at Golden Goblin Press, it's like, it's a 35-year-old game. If it seems obvious, for God's sake, we are not doing it.
Let's do
some pathfinding. Find some new ground, for God's sake.
You know, spin some new ideas and take, you know, be different. Don't have to be held to what the monsters are in the rule book. You know, go to great lengths in some tradition to try and set the beginning of the monsters. You know, describe them in unusual ways. Don't make them all the same. You know, make them unusual, make them unique, and create your own. And you know, enjoy being a keeper, and you know, have, you know, be creative and do stuff. But, because that will freak your players out far more, especially if they think it's a shrug off and it isn't. It's something completely different. You know, or they think it's a deep one, and yes, it looks like a fish frog man, but it does something completely unlike any other deep one they've ever done. That will scare them.
Right. You really want to have some fun? Take a monster everybody knows, double its size and half its intelligence, or double its intelligence and half its size.
Yeah.
And just play it that way and watch the dominoes fall. I've done that more than once.
Okay, well, we have had a wonderful day here today with all of you. Our many thanks to Mike Mason, Oscar Rios, Matthew Sanderson, Thomas McKean, Jeff Wilkins, and Mick Swann for their participation. Thanks to all those who participated via chat. Thanks for all of your excellent questions. Feel free to post comments on the show. We'd love to hear from you. An audio version of our show will shortly be posted on Podbean and iTunes, free to download. If you enjoyed our broadcast, please give us a thumbs up and subscribe to our channels for updates on our latest shows. If you'd like to support us in other ways, we've just opened a Patreon account. Your contributions will help us to continue to improve and expand our content. You'll find links to our website, our Patreon account, Podbean, iTunes, and our Twitter pages in the description below. This is Tom Raley inviting you to journey with us once again into the darkness for another adventure into the universe of H.P. Lovecraft and the Call of Cthulhu role-playing game. Until next time, good luck and good gaming.